Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Boarding House by Carol Ervin, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. Someone was trying to find me. The letter came from a lawyer's office in Philadelphia, printed by type machine on paper crisp as parchment, dated August 4, 1919, and signed in elegant script. The paper cut my finger, a deep, painful slash that dripped blood. I pressed the cut to my tongue while I read the letter again. It did not identify the person inquiring, merely asked if I was May Rose Percy, approximately 38, raised in Stillwater, Ohio, by Bert and Sweet Johnson. I had no reason to assume the letter meant bad news. It might be seeking information about someone I'd known as a child in Ohio. I was tempted to toss it away, but the paper and signature looked too important to disregard, as though ignoring it might put me, and thereby all of us, at risk. The idea of being found should not have been frightening. I was innocent of wrongdoing, but knew well that innocence did not always ward off evil. I'd had more than one nightmare in which I was arrested, tried, and judged guilty of being married to a murderer, my first husband, Jamie Long. Blood dripped on the letter and spread into a blot above my name. I dug in my apron pocket for a handkerchief to press against the cut and tucked the blood-stained letter into my account book. Here was one more troubling thing to discuss with Barlow when he returned from his sales trip. I'd had no letter from him for 3 days. Surely that meant he was on his way home. The room where I stood was at a front corner of the boarding house, near the wide entryway and across from the parlor. It was meant to be a cloakroom, but on admitting our first residence, Barlow and I had realized we did not want to conduct business in our apartment. We'd taken the coat hooks from the walls and added a small desk, chairs, and a lamp. I usually kept the door open, but today I not only closed the door when I left, I considered locking it. I didn't go that far, but I did carry the account book to the apartment and secured it in our parlor desk. Then I peeked into the children's playroom to satisfy myself that all was well. Back in the hallway, I hurried toward the kitchen without looking to see or stopping to greet the man starting down the center stairs. I knew, of course, who it was. We had only two guests, husband and wife. He had a heavy tread, and she seldom left her room. My need for privacy had changed in the 3 months since we'd accepted strangers into our boarding house, and I now understood the adage about familiarity breeding contempt. I didn't want to be well known or found by anyone except people I trusted. Next to our own apartment, the kitchen was my favorite room, partly because my friend Luzana was almost always there with her welcoming smile and help for any urgent need. With Barlow on sales trips, I'd quickly found I couldn't manage the house, the cooking, cleaning, laundry, and our two small children, even with only two guests. So I'd hired Luzana and her daughter, Emmy. Less than 2 years after selling his share of the Winkler mine, Barlow had gone back to work for his former partners, not as business manager, but as a salesman. In our present circumstances, we were lucky he had this job, but it had never been part of our plan. We were supposed to operate the boarding house together, making decisions and doing most of the work ourselves. I'd expected to have abundant time to spend with Freddie, nearly three, and Hetty, who'd just learned to stand alone. My husband wasn't meant to be gone for weeks at a time. Luzana was leaning on our kitchen work table, turning pages of yesterday's Fairmont, West Virginian. "The Women's Christian Temperance Union is for giving us the vote," she said, keeping her eyes on the paper. In June, the federal government had approved the 19th Amendment to the Constitution, acknowledging that no citizen could be barred from voting on the basis of sex. Now it had to be ratified by the states. Many had already done so, and West Virginia newspapers were full of comments and notices of rallies. She turned another page, still not looking up. I like how the WCTU says women has better morals than men and will elect better leaders. I'd say the morals part is true, judging by men I've knowed. What do you think? I haven't thought about it. Our countertop egg basket was empty. The egg and butter man was here today, wasn't he? Where did you put the eggs?
Cellarway. Our morals is better than men's, wouldn't you say?
I'm sure I admire more women than men, but except for the men in our families, we never get to know their minds or natures very well. Not like I know you, and you know me, and we know Piney and Wanda and the rest of us. Egg salad for lunch, all right with you?
Seasoned with a little bacon, she said. I'll whip up the dressing. I'd like a man who's as good as my friends.
What? Luzanna always said she'd had enough worthless husbands and would not waste herself on another. I waited until she glanced up from the paper, then said, I'm not going to forget that.
Bacon? Dressing?
That you'd like a husband.
Whoa, Nellie. I mean, I wish my husbands had been as good to me as my friends. Lord, can you imagine me with more kids? I'm better off as I am. I like this work.
Which is my good fortune, I said. If she married, she might leave me and concentrate on her own household. But like every woman who's happy with her husband, I wanted the same good fortune for my friends. Our work in the boarding house was unending, but Luzanna claimed its steadiness and dependability was easier than gathering up and washing laundry from the town bachelors and sewing gloves late at night. Since she and her children had begun taking most of their meals in our kitchen, her cheeks had filled out, and at times she looked almost as pretty as her girls. She refolded and smoothed the newspaper, making it suitable for the parlor table.
Women against the vote talk like all of us has a good man to lean on. I bet a nickel all of them against it has rich husbands, or fathers and maids and such, and never worked a minute in their lives, like our Mrs. Chapman.
We continued to speculate about the vote and about women of leisure as we prepared lunch for Mr. and Mrs. Chapman, my children, Luzanna's two, and ourselves. Work being necessary for our security, we were perplexed and irritated by the idleness of our current guests. I didn't know if Mrs. Chapman had opinions. Indeed, I had no idea what she did in her room all day long.
She's an odd one, Luzanna whispered.
In her place, I'd go mad. Rona Chapman was the second woman I'd met who didn't work morning to night, the other being Barlow's first wife, Alice, who'd seemed to crave an important duty but found no dignified opportunity. Childless like Mrs. Chapman, Alice had spent her day reading and worrying about the news and forming her strong opinions. Barlow's sister Hester had not approved of her, but both Alice and Hester would have wanted the right to vote. Since building the boarding house, I'd thought and spoken often of Hester Townsend. We'd modeled it after the one she'd operated nearly on the same ground. Too late, I'd learned that my memory of her boarding house was not entirely correct. It had not paid for itself, though it had seemed busy and prosperous. The difference, Barlow explained, was that he and his sister had not borne the cost of building and furnishing it. Much of that had come from his two elderly cousins, who'd become its permanent residents. Thus far, we'd not had enough guests to meet expenses. Instead of being able to work with my husband every day, my ambition to operate an enterprise like Hester's now separated us for weeks at a time. Already, I wondered if we should give it up. Often in dreams, I seemed to be someone else, wandering on unknown paths and cliffs, searching, following, or hiding from unknown groups of people, traveling on, never knowing where.
Now, with Barlow away so many lonely weeks, I sometimes dreamed of the two of us, heated and desperate to cling together, frustrated because people were in our room watching. That night, my dream frightened me awake, for I'd been myself, and parts of the dream had been too real. I'd seen the chinked walls of the mountain cabin, the skillets hanging on the wall above the stove, the butchering knives on raw hide ropes. Cold air had rushed through the open door, and I'd risen from the bed in the corner, wondering if Jamie had come home in the night, or if he'd gone out and left the door open. I'd called his name, but couldn't hear my voice over the shrill of wind. I'd stood in the open door, searching the dome of starry sky and untracked blue-white snow, but Jamie was nowhere to be found. And I knew he'd run away, and maybe that was why a logging train had stopped on the tracks near the cabin. There could be no other reason, for trains never went down the mountain in the middle of the night. The flat cars were piled high with logs and men who laughed and pointed but made no sound, and I closed the door because I was naked and cold. Then Jamie had appeared, wearing his sheepskin coat, but the day was too hot for a coat, and he'd thrown it on the floor and taken off his shirt and stepped out of his trousers and pulled me to the bed. This bed, the one in the boarding house, with everyone watching. Afraid to go back to sleep, I sat up until I had a good sense of what was real and what was not. This dream of Jamie was not as terrifying as the one where I kept trying to fasten the cabin door against a pack of wolves, and not nearly as frightening as the one in which I stood helpless as Freddy fell under the hooves and wheels of a horse-drawn wagon. Barlow's arms had helped me recover from those dreams, but even if he were beside me now, I couldn't tell him about this one. Learning that someone was trying to find me was only the start of disturbing events. The next afternoon, while Luzanna and I were shredding cabbage and peeling potatoes for dinner, my stepdaughter rushed into the kitchen looking like she'd had a fright. "Wanda? My goodness me," Luzanna said. Wanda breezed past us to the hallway door, motioning me to follow. "Let's talk a minute." She was out of wind, like she'd run all the way from her house or from the company store where she worked when she wasn't helping her husband in his medical practice. I wiped my hands and hurried after her into the hall, concerned that she needed to relay something not only urgent, but too private to share even with Luzanna, our closest friend. Wanda passed the door to my apartment, glanced into the parlor, and continued to the front porch, where she stopped and scrutinized the landscape. Apparently satisfied that no one else could hear, she plopped into one of the porch rockers like her legs had given way. She'd made me too anxious to sit. "You won't believe this," she said. "It's impossible. Guess who showed up?" Her eyes shifted back and forth, a nervous habit I thought she'd conquered. The afternoon was hot, but my skin turned cold and damp. I could think of only one person whose impossible appearance would make my voice tremble like hers. I whispered, "Jamie?" From where I stood, I could see the spot where I'd seen him for the last time, the back gate of Hester's boarding house. Railroad employees had brought out the dead and injured after a trestle collapsed, plunging a train into a gully, but they'd not found one passenger, assumed to be Jamie Long, wanted for murder. Occasionally, when I was feeling blessed to be with Barlow, I'd have a brief fear that Jamie would appear, expecting us to take up as before, even though his brother said he'd found and buried him, even though Russell had brought me the money from Jamie's coat and said he'd kept Jamie's gun. I knew where Jamie had gotten the money, and I knew he'd had a gun. He'd shown it to me. Wanda fanned her face with her hand. "Pa? No. Someone way worse." For me, there could be no one worse. If Jamie Long should turn up alive, Barlow and I might not be legally married. I didn't know the law. Jamie had been presumed dead for nearly 20 years. Wanda's usual manner in confronting a problem was to attack it head-on or dismiss it with a wave of her hand. She now waved it in a confused way, as though her hand could help get her words out. "It's old Mrs. Donnelly," she said. I had not recovered from the terror of Jamie ruining our lives. "Not the very same. Calls herself Mrs. Herf now, but I recognized her right off, and I guess she could be Mrs. Herf if she married nobody after Will's pa died." My feelings about the woman were deeper and more bitter than Wanda's. Irene Donnelly had repeated the lies that I'd displayed myself without clothes to loggers from her husband's camp. She'd called me a whore. Wanda rushed on. "She must know the old man is dead, 'cause she didn't ask for him. She asked for Will. Can you beat that? Lordy, she's still Will's stepma, my stepma-in-law. I can't bear it." I dropped into a chair and squeezed the armrests. The Donnellys had plagued our earliest days in Winkler. I hated that the mother of the clan was making a claim on Will, especially considering her family's damage to his. "Do you suppose we'll have to tell Luzanna? And if we do, what will we say?" Unfortunately, our friend had been married to Irene's older son, John Donnelly. Wanda got up and paced on the porch. "We never told Luzanna that her husband's ma was married to Will's stinker of a pa, did we? I almost forgot it myself. Will said them two wasn't together much more than a month before her and her boys was kicked out of town." I told no one. It was an easy secret to keep because we didn't like to think about it. We hadn't even told Luzanna we'd known her husband when he was a boy, partly to protect her and her children and partly to protect ourselves.
"I don't think I blabbed," Wanda said. "No, I'm sure I didn't. But sometimes when I think I've forgotten something, it pops out loose-like."
I wonder if Irene knows Luzanna and her children are here.
I'd say she don't, 'cause she would have asked for them too, wouldn't she? She come into the store half an hour ago, and age ain't improved her. She walks like she can hardly put one fat foot in front of the other. I don't think she recognized me, though there's no reason she should, 'cause I grew up and she just grew old. Will was out on a call, so I told her to come around later. She said she'd heard somewhere that her stepson had made himself a doctor and owner of a coal mine to boot. She sat down at the store table, said she'd just wait. There's other clerks there today, so I left her. What do you think she wants?" Nothing good. The last time I'd seen Irene, she was threatening to shoot Will's father with a shotgun. In those days, the town belonged to the Winkler Lumber and Logging Company. The town guard had said if she didn't take her boys away, he was going to send them to reform school. "If she sticks around, she'll find out about Luzanna's Emmy and Tim. Poor kids, to have such a granny. At least their pa can't come back, can he? Lou's sure he's dead?"
"Killed in a mine. John and his brother both. She saw the bodies." Wanda puffed a loud breath of air.
"I know it ain't right to say I'm glad somebody's dead, but I can't help it. If that woman lets loose one word of brag about her boys, I might spit out what they done to us."
I'd had too many bad thoughts for one day. For sure, we have some confessions to make to Luzanna.
"Maybe not yet. Probably the old woman's just come to get money from Will. Maybe she'll leave and we won't have to explain a thing. All right, gotta go."
Like everything was now settled, Wanda bounced up and rushed down the path. I did not return to the kitchen when Wanda left. I went to my apartment. I needed to hug my children, and I needed my husband to come home. This house we wanted so much had separated us, sending him to sleep in hot hotel rooms, ride dusty trains, and wait every day in the offices of power plant operators for a chance to ask them to buy coal from the Winkler mine. I was the lucky one. While he was on the road, he lived without the consolation of family, but I could hold Freddy and Hetty at any time. The children were sitting in a circle on the playroom floor with Emmy, Luzanna's daughter, who every day looked more like a young lady. I stood in the doorway as she put a block in Hetty's hand and helped her set it on Freddy's stack. At her age, Hetty did not have the coordination to build, but she'd learned how to destroy, and she liked the effect. With a swing of her arm, she tumbled Freddy's blocks across the floor. Freddy yelled, leaned forward, and gave his sister a shove. Emmy caught her, but Hetty cried anyway. Emmy looked at me like she needed to be rescued. "Go, keep your ma company," I said. "I'll stay with the children for a while." At 3 and 1, my children did not play well together. But at 13, Emmy seemed extraordinarily grown up. She was also patient and good-natured. I did not want her to learn the bad things I knew about her father and his family, just as I did not want her to hear the bad things they'd said about me. Chapter 2. Much as I needed the money from their two rooms, I wished Milton Chapman and his wife would leave. He watched me all the time, appraising me up and down when I walked into the parlor or met him in the hall, estimating his chances, pulling on his silky mutton chops or shifting his unlit cigar between his teeth, not taking the step back to allow a polite space between us. So certain of himself in his long motoring coat and cap or in the golf knickers he called plus fours, though there was no golf course in Winkler nor in any other town in the region, trying to convince us he was a somebody in a place he called the backwater of nowhere. Thus far, I'd been able to compose my face and act like I didn't know what was on his mind. I thought often of Hester Townsend, a well-preserved, unmarried woman who'd had to deal with difficult boarders and must have learned how to fend off unwanted advances. I tried to imitate her stiff posture and confident tone, but the colder I became, the more he twisted his thin lips in a smile. He seemed to know how to find me alone, like that afternoon. In the middle of most days, Luzanna went home to see if her boy Tim was into any mischief, and sometimes to lie down for a rest because her days in the boarding house were long. I was chopping potatoes for salad, standing at the long porcelain work table in the center of the room when the door from the dining room swung open.
"So this is where you keep yourself?"
Milton Chapman stepped into the room, letting the door swing shut behind him. In hot weather, we kept only the smallest fire in the cook stove. A fan in the corner moved air in my direction, yet my face was moist, my underarms sticky, and on both my chest and back, beads of sweat rolled down beneath my chemise. I dabbed my forehead with a dish towel, giving myself a moment to hide my irritation. "May I help you?" He leaned against the dish cabinet like he intended to stay and chat. I'd never known a man who had no apparent occupation other than a nightly attendance at the roadhouse, and I resented the way he lounged in the parlor and lurked in passageways, always underfoot, in Luzanna's words. His only response was a smile that, to me, looked wicked. "Please tell Mrs. Chapman I've set iced tea in the parlor," I said. "You might like to take your glasses outside. The summer house is the coolest spot this time of day." I knew this from Emmy's report, for I seldom had time to sit there myself. Barlow and I had imagined the lattice-walled summer house as our daily retreat, a place to rest on chintz-covered chairs, watch the river splash over its rocks, and enjoy the shade while the children played on the cool stone floor. Milton Chapman shrugged.
Rona is resting in her room. I can't explain it, can you? She does nothing, yet she's always tired.
He had the look and stature of a man who might be my age, but his wife looked older. I had no explanation, and I'd wondered too, but it didn't seem proper for him to speak about her to anyone but the closest family.
Then we'll see you at dinner, I said. 6 o'clock as usual.
He didn't need to be reminded. I was dismissing him from the room. He didn't move.
You're looking fine this afternoon. A drop of moisture on your cheek, a loose strand of hair there by your ear. I could write a poem.
I pressed my hands on the table between us, rejecting the kind of sharp response that would put him in his place, wondering what Hester would do. She'd say something that wouldn't sound defensive, but would catch him off guard.
Mr. Chapman, are your accommodations satisfactory?
His look changed to one of pretended surprise and injury.
Most certainly, quite satisfied. I should say very. Have I implied that anything is wrong?
If you intend to continue as our guest, you must respect the privacy of everyone in the house, including mine. At the present time, I need this kitchen to myself. I did not worry about offending him. It was unlikely he and Rona would leave until their house was finished, which might be as late as next spring. When construction began, they'd stayed with her brother's family, an arrangement she claimed did not suit them, as though it was not good enough. Getting to know Milton Chapman, I suspected her brother had asked them to leave.
Anything you like, he said. Will it be all right if I pass through the kitchen to get to the summer house?
The summer house is nearer the front. There's a flagstone path from the porch. At this moment, Luzanna entered the kitchen from the back door. She stopped and looked from me to the unwelcome guest.
She wants the kitchen to herself, he said to Luzanna. We'll meet at dinner then.
He stopped and reversed his course.
I'll carry out a glass of tea from the parlor, as you suggested, taking the route from the front this time, never fear.
Luzanna and I sighed together when the door closed behind him.
I hope you lock yourself in at night, she said, and not just with one of them old skeleton keys.
There's a deadbolt. I hadn't shared my apprehensions about him with anyone, but Luzanna didn't have to be told.
I met the telegraph boy out front.
She held out the unmistakable brown paper. It's for you. I had to sit down. A third piece of disturbing news might do me in.
It don't have to be something bad, she said.
Of course not. I opened the seal, unfolded the paper, and let my breath go.
It's from Barlow. He's coming home.
All's well then, she said. So it seemed. Only memories of Hester Townsend got me through dinners alone with Milton and Rona Chapman. In the early days of their stay, I'd smoothed my hair and changed for dinner. But now, if my dress was not stained or sweat-ringed, I merely patted my face dry and removed my apron. One reason for my carelessness was Milton Chapman's excessive compliments about my appearance, and the other was his wife Rona, who seemed to make an effort to look her worst. Rona Chapman had features that might have been handsome on a man: a high forehead, a long, slightly bent nose, and a square jaw.
curls would have softened her face, but she wound her hair in a bun that seemed to tighten the corners of her eyes and the flesh of her thin cheeks. Even in summer, she wore brown or gray dresses with long sleeves and high collars. She had more attractive clothing. When cleaning her room, I'd seen stylish hats and bright, filmy dresses, reminders that I knew nothing about her. Our evening dinner was nearly the only time we were together, and I'd given up trying to engage her in conversation. "Eat up, my dear," her husband said at every meal. "We're paying for it, you know." When I greeted Mr. and Mrs. Chapman at dinner that evening, my mind was both uneasy about Irene Donnelly's return to Winkler and excited at the prospect of having Barlow home soon. With no other guests, it did not matter if Milton Chapman dominated the table talk. All I needed to do was ask how the house was coming along and nod at intervals. "I have to keep right on my builders or they slack off," he said. "Mrs. Townsend, you should ride out with me to inspect it. There's enough framed up so you'll see what a grand place it's going to be. Rona will come too, of course." I glanced at his wife, but she was picking a fork through her potato salad like she was looking for bugs. I intended to be too busy to go anywhere with him, even if she should come along. I'd never seen them leave the house together, but she often went for walks in the evening when he was out. "My associates question why I'm building in such a remote area, though Rona's brother thinks his family's land comprises God's finest acres. Ours will be the best house in the county, a proper estate for a judge." His wife glanced up. "You might tell your associates you're building there because the land is my inheritance." In 3 weeks, I'd rarely heard Rona Chapman say more than, "if you please" and "no thank you." Her husband seemed equally surprised.
"I thought you wanted to be close to your family. I could have bought land anywhere."
"It will be hard to live where we're not wanted." She now addressed me. "My husband only wants my inheritance because my brother hates the idea of him having it. It's part of the land our father farmed, with cropland, pastures, and a fine barn built by my brother."
"He shouldn't have built the barn on your portion of the estate," he said.
"My father was alive at the time. The property hadn't been divided." They weren't talking to each other. This was for my enlightenment.
"The house will be our summer place," he said. "As a judge, I'll need a second home closer to the county seat."
"If he's elected," she said, "someone might seek the office who actually knows a thing or two about the law." I nearly choked. With a satisfied look, Rona now stirred her potato salad like she was making soup. Her judgment did not seem to disturb him.
"Some people may think I'm wasting my evenings at the roadhouse, but I'm making friends for future advancement. Everyone from lowly miners to newspaper publishers."
I did not doubt the roadhouse had a large clientele. It was not only a public source for illegal whiskey, but a gambling site for wealthier men in the region, and as there were few rooms anywhere else for rent, a well-known place of secret encounters. "My husband won't be elected from this county unless he wins the endorsement of the miners' union," Rona said. "And if enough states ratify the 19th Amendment, he'll also have to get the women's vote." He forked a piece of meat into his mouth and spoke as he chewed.
"They should be easily persuadable, as very few give signs of intelligent thought. But I understand most decent women are against the amendment. We voted it down before, and I'm confident our legislator will do the same again."
It's been half a century in coming, his wife said, instructing me. 15 states ratified the amendment almost immediately. We need only 20 more. This time, we're going to get it. Milton Chapman winked.
My wife admires those suffragettes who disrupt political meetings and thrust themselves into prominence by carrying signs on public streets. Personally, she's timid as a mouse.
She made no sign of taking offense. I also admired the suffragettes, but not wanting to prolong the argument, I tried to turn the topic with my own best piece of news. Mr. Townsend will be with us tomorrow evening. When they showed no interest, I drifted into my own reverie. Most of the time, I thought only of the task at hand, but since yesterday, I'd worried more than once about the letter in my account book and the reappearance of Irene Donnelly. Before dinner, Wanda had come again with a proposal that gave me goosebumps. She'd found me in our apartment, feeding the children while Emmy took my place in the kitchen.
It's business, Wanda said. You run a boarding house, and the old crow is set on living in Winkler. We'll pay you to keep her as a boarder.
Little Hetty's mouth was open, waiting for the spoon. I'd paused in midair. My mouth hung open, too, stuck, dry for lack of words.
At least say you'll think about it, Wanda said. She says Will must take care of her. You know how he is. He might let her live with us, but we've no place for her to sleep. He's willing to pay her room and board.
I can't have her here, I said. She probably still hates me.
Well, then, maybe Louisiana's the one to take her in. Maybe if we tell Irene about her son's widow and grandkids being right here, she'll want to be with them.
Please, hasn't Louisiana had enough bad luck? It would be better to pay someone else to keep her. Someone far away where she won't bother us.
I guess we could try that, Wanda said.
For now, we've got to tell Louisiana how we knew the Donnellys and explain why we didn't tell her a long time ago. If we revealed everything, Louisiana would understand why we'd held back the story, but I wasn't sure I could go that far. I'll tell her in the morning. Do you want to be here?
Not particularly. Don't tell the bad stuff them boys did to us.
Not unless I have to. It would hurt her to know. Not that she had any respect for John Donnelly. But I think I need to tell about Jamie, because unless Irene has experienced a miraculous conversion, she'll be stirring all that up again. Louisiana and I had always chatted whenever we worked together, but this history required a sit-down. I chose the time immediately after breakfast, when Emmy took the children back to our apartment. Louisiana's older daughter had gone away to college, and only her younger two lived with her now. Unlike the oldest, Emmy and her brother Tim were John Donnelly's offspring, and I hoped nobody would tell their grandmother about them until I had a chance to warn Louisiana. We sat at the small breakfast table. Louisiana and I were about the same age, but she'd had a harder life. Her best feature was her voice, soft and warm. She'd been so good to me. I thought I'd do anything to keep her from further harm. There's something I should have told you long ago, I said. She sat straighter and clutched the edge of the table. Oh, my good Lord, are you all right? I'm fine. I need to tell you something about my past. I don't like to talk about it, and there's been no reason for you to know. But now it's important? It's important. Yes. Things are going to come out about me and some others. I'm sorry to say there's a connection to your family. Her eyes were wide. A sorry connection to my family and I didn't know?
Here it is. Wanda and I knew your husband long ago when we all lived in Winkler.
I watched her face. All right, she said. That's not too bad, though I can guess that knowing him might not have been a blessing. I'm glad Emmy and Tim don't remember much about him. They was little when him and his brother was killed.
It was terrible to be glad that the Donnelly boys were beyond hurting us, but the years had not softened my feelings about them. When we knew them, your husband and his brother were in their teens, a few years older than Wanda. I also knew their mother, Irene. Did you ever meet her?
I never did. And all I know is John and her never got along. Him and me met in a mining camp. He said his ma moved around, and I don't think he knew where she was.
She's here in Winkler now.
She isn't! What a wonder! But I guess this was home at one time.
Does she know me and the kids are here? Is that why she come? I wasn't sure John told her anything about us. It's Will she came to see. Heard about him somewhere. I haven't talked with her. Frankly, she and I did not get on.
Luzanna took a deep, audible breath and blew it out from puffed cheeks. I guess that's the sorry part, but don't worry. It comes as no surprise. John called her terrible names, his own ma, but maybe him and her was alike. Lordy, I suppose I'll have to meet her. Introduce her to the kids and all. Did she come to Will for doctoring?
Now I got to the sorry part. We didn't like keeping this from you, but we thought the less you knew, the better. She and Will's father were married for a short time.
Luzanna knew I'd taken care of Will and his brother and sister to pay my way in Hester's boarding house, but she didn't know the end of that story. Mrs. Donnelly had also needed a job, and she not only attacked me for it, she got it by marrying Will's father. The worst effect was not that I lost the small income, but that Will and Charlie had to live with her sons.
Married?
Luzanna leaned back in her chair and laughed. My John's ma and Will's pa? A short time? Well, I would have loved to know that. Why was it a short time?
There was a huge fight. Your husband and his brother were involved. There was shooting, and she left town with the boys to keep from being arrested.
Shooting? That seems right, knowing John. Do you have any idea if she knows her boys are dead?
I don't know. In fact, if she learns I'm here, I'm sure she'll be telling everyone that I was married to the man who murdered her husband.
Good Lord, this gets worse and worse. Are you saying Barlow killed Will's pa?
The sun had been up only a few hours, and already I was perspiring from the rising heat, the effort of explaining, and mostly from imagining the trouble Mrs. Donnelly would inflict. Not Barlow, and not Will's pa. This is all so mixed up, and it's always been terrible to think about. You'll see why I didn't want to tell you. Will's father was Mrs. Donnelly's second husband. My first husband, Jamie Long, worked in the same lumber camp as Andrew Donnelly. They got into a fight, which was probably nothing unusual. I never knew if both had knives or just Jamie, but he won that fight, and he was accused of murder.
Luzanna rested an elbow on the table and supported her forehead with her hand. Well,
This is a lot to take in. Now she was watching me. I'm sure that was a bad time, and I see why you didn't want to tell it. She reached her hand across the table. It's got nothing to do with you and me. Irene said the fight was my fault. If she slanders me, I'll survive. But unless she's reformed herself, you won't want her anywhere near Emmy and Tim. I wasn't ready to reveal the reason she blamed me, not even to my closest friend. You got nothing to be ashamed of, but I doubt she's reformed. People don't change. Who else knows all this? As far as I know, Wanda, Will, and Barlow are the only ones who were here at the time. Will's brother Charlie was here too, but you know Charlie's memory comes and goes. Their sister was just a baby. Well, if you all don't want to tell her about me, there might be an answer, Luzanna said. I feel no obligation to her. I could say we're a different bunch of Donnellys, no relation at all. We'd go along with that, but I doubt it would work unless we could get her out of town quickly. Maybe you don't see it, but Wanda and I do. Your Tim is the spitting image of John Donnelly. Chapter 3. When Wanda rushed into the kitchen the next morning, I took one look at her face and shook my head.
It's too late to get the old witch away.
She stopped, seeing Luzanna's children at the table. Emmy and Tim stopped eating and got big-eyed. Breakfast is done. Luzanna lifted Hetty from the high chair and passed her to Emmy. Tim, you go to the mill and help Simpson. Mind I said help, not hang about and get in his way. If he's got nothing for you to do, come right back here. Wanda tightened her lips until the children left the room. I told Luzanna we knew her husband and how his father was killed, I said. Luzanna smiled. It's all right. I got no hard feelings. Wanda slid into a chair.
Well, I'd hate...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.